Uma pressão.
Vou aqui. So, Trivin, we have.
Sir.
I'm going to share the screen. So, today I will discuss about some, you know, what type of requirement, okay, the job responsibilities requirement in the cybersecurity sort of things. So, how do you, you know, work? What sort of things required? So, first thing is a bachelor or a master's degree in computer science or information security and equivalent. So you required some, you know what, degree, master degree or you know what, you required some bachelor degree in computer science or information security or equivalent sort of things, right? Second thing is you required some strong grasp of authentication principles. So the thing is important to understand here, that authentication principles. So what you understand by this authentication principles. So how it is going to working? So availability, integrity, and availability represent, it's the basic requirement that should be granted for successful authentication system, right? So authentication is required everywhere, okay? And personality verification taken multiple forms depending on different processing types, and they are divided into the knowledge based, token based, and biometric based authentications, okay? So we can decide that we have you know what, divided into the knowledge based, okay, and token based and biometric based authentications. So what do you understand by a knowledge based? Suppose you know the password of the application, if the knowledge, and the token based, you have RSA VPN token is there, you have a biometric sort of things, your fingerprint sensors, eye retinal scanner, okay? So this is sort of things you required same time. So this is the sort of things you require for the authentication. So we have different authentication sort of things, so we can go for more principal authentication. So we have so what is the process of authentications, right? So the process of identity of an individual usually based on the username and a password. In security systems, authentication is distinct from authorization, which is in the process of giving individuals access to systems object based on their identity. So what type of, you know, authentication is the one thing? AAA, authentication, authorization, and accounting. Okay, so authentication is basically we can say that distinct from authentication, which is the process of giving individuals access. Suppose you required some access about some different sort of things, so I will provide you access. Okay, so it is called is a account authorization sort of things, and system object based on their identity. So what is authentication and authorization? So we have two things available here. So difference between authentication and authorization. So authentication means confirming your own. So authentication is tell that who you are, what's your user ID, it's your authentication. Okay. And what's your password? So once you provide the right user ID and password into the system, it tells the authentication same times. While authorizations means granting access to the system. Okay, so what sort of things you can do it on the system? Do the user have the admin access or not? This is comes under authorization. In simple terms, authentication is the process of verifying who you are, and authorization is the process of verifying that what you have to access to. Okay, so authentication means that who you are. So we have three ways. We can token based authentications, we have multi-factor authentications, we have biometric authentications, we have identity scanners for so the authentications and authorization, what you can do. Okay, so the thing is, user authentication is a process that allows a device to verify the identity of the someone who connects to a network resources. There are many technologies currently available in the network administrator to authenticate users. The Firefox has also its own authentication server. Right? So how to authenticate a user? So when the user is on the page, you will ask to enter the username and password, enter the username and website server and compare with the information in the file, and when a match is found, you will able to enter the account same time. So you need to understand what's the authentication basically. The authentication is the, what is authentication example? Suppose you want to provide a example. In computing, authentication is a process of verifying that the identity of a person or device. In computing, authentication is basically process of verifying identity of a person or a device. A common example is to entering a username and a password when you are logging to the website. While a username password combination is the common way to authenticate your identity, and many of the types of authentication exist. Okay, so if you are logging to the website, if you log into your system, so it's the authentications, you're the authentic user or not. Okay, so there are three types of authentications, something you know, something you have, we have to go for the some what is multi-factor authentication. So multi-factor authentication is a method of login verification at least two different factors of proof of required. So multi-factor authentication is referred to as a two-factor authentication, which stands for two-factor authentication. MFA helps keep protect your data, email, financial accounts, health records, etc. Right, so what type of multi-factor authentication? So we have something you know, something you have, and something you are. So something you know, what you know, you know the passwords, you know the pin numbers, you know the combinations of code words, of secret handshakes, and think that you can remember, and then type, say, do, perform, or otherwise recall, then needs to fail into the category. So something you know, it means that what the password you know. Second thing is something you have. What you have includes all the items that are physically objects, such as key, smartphones, smart cards, USB drives, token devices. A token device produces a time-based pin or can compute the from a challenge number of using servers. So something you know, something you have. So you have tokens, you have USB drives, you have token drives, you have smartphones, you have smart cards. So what something you are it includes any part of the human body that can be offered for verification, such as fingerprints, palm scanning, facial recognition, retina scans, iris scans, and voice verifications. So these are the things something you are basically. So by combining two or more factors from these three categories, a multi-factor authentication is crafted. A multi-factor authentication is preferred as the it is much more difficult or it's intruders to overcome. With just password, an attacker only has to have a single attack, wage of single successful attack. With the multi-factor authentication, the attacker must have multiple attack skills, have wage multiple successful attacks. Simultaneously, in order to uncover the victim, the extremely difficult and thus the most resilient login solution. So you understand what is authentication is all about? What is the multi-factor authentication is all about? So we understand authentication principles. So we have principles, basically the CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. Authentication basically who the person you are, such as MFA, multi-factor authentication, OTP, and challenge response. So this is three-way handshaking. You know what? We can say that. Understanding of web application security, common web vulnerabilities, and web controls. So we have going to understand another this one as well. So my dear friends, this is the web application WA. What is application security? If somebody will ask you that, what is, how do you going to do it? So you can say web application security is a central component of any web businesses. The global nature of the internet exposed web properties to attack from different locations and various levels of skills and complexity. Web application security deals especially with the security surrounding the websites. Okay, so web application basically it is deals with the what type of security on the websites, web applications and web services such as APIs. So what type of application program may be API security and what are the applications? Okay, so what are the common vulnerabilities on the web security vulnerabilities? So cross-site scripting access. Access is a vulnerability that allows an attacker to inject client-side scripts into a web page in order to access import important information directly, impersonate the user or trick the user into delivering important information. So access is cross-site scripting. Basically, it is a vulnerability that allows the attacker to inject client-side scripts into a web page in order to access important information directly. Interpersonate the trick of the user into the living important information. So once the client system is, you know what, access the website, at the same time the attacker is allows and the inject client-side scripts. So there are different scripts is running at the back end of this particular website. Okay, so accesses basically cross-site scripting, basically the attacker is going to attack the same time on the cross-site scripts. We have some another SQL injection SQI. So SQI is a method by which an attacker exploits vulnerabilities in the way a database executes search queries. So SQL injection is basically a method by which the attacker exploits the vulnerabilities in the way of the database execute such queries. That attackers use SQL injection to gain access to unauthorized information, modify or to create new user permissions, otherwise manipulate the destroy sensitive information. So SQL injection basically it is used for, you know what, to, you know what, database execute such queries. Different, you know what, executions queries you can run it. And second thing is collecting access to unauthorized information. Okay, modify or create new user permissions, or otherwise manipulate the destroy sensitive data. So in the SQL injections, once you're going to inject SQL injections, you can just, I'm going to provide some database execute queries same time, and you can provide unauthorized access informations and modify or to create the new user permissions, otherwise manipulate or destroy sensitive data at the same time. This is the SQL injection, the web applications. Cross-site scripting is one of them. Denial of service attacks, distributed denial of service attacks is through a variety of vector attacker are able to get server or its surrounding infrastructure with different types of attacks traffic. When a server is no longer be able to effectively process an incoming request, it begins to behave sluggishly and eventually deny service to incoming requests and eliminate the users. So through the variety of attackers are able to overload the targeted servers. Okay, so what is the DDoS attack? It's able to overload the targeted servers or its surrounding infrastructure with different types of different attack. So this is one of the memory corruptions. Memory corruption occurs where a location is memory is unintentionally modified, resulting in the potential of unexpected behavior in the software. Bad actors will be attempt to sniff out the exploit memory corruption through exploits such as code injections or buffer overflow attack. So memory corruption is basically what the location of the memory is intentionally modified. buffer overflow. Buffer overflow is occurs when software writing to a defined space in memory known as buffer. Okay, so buffer overflow is buffer overflow can anomaly that occurs when software writing data to a defined space in the memory known as buffer. Overflowing is the buffer's capacity results in adjacent memory locations being overwritten with data. This behavior can be exploited to the inject malicious code into memory, potentially creating a vulnerability in the targeted machine. So buffer overflow is basically it's an anomaly that occurs when software writing data to a defined space memory. Okay, suppose any device have a memory, so we have full the memory. Okay, at the same time as the full the memory in the buffer is overflows every time, and at the same time the buffer overflow capacity results in adjacent memory locations and overwritten the data. So you can dislocate the memory same time and overwritten the data in the memory. This behavior can be exploited when inject malicious code into memory. At the same time, so you can put the code into this memory, potentially creating a vulnerability in the target machine. Call of site request for Gary is cross site request for Gary involves taking a victim into making a request that utilize their authentications or authorizations by leveraging account privileges as a user and attacker capable to send them the request masquerading as the user. Once the user's account has been compromised, the attacker can exfiltrate, destroy or modify important information. Higher privileged account such as administrator or executor are commonly targeted. So cross-site request is formally is involved taking a victim into a making a request. Okay, just hold on. Hello. Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Hello.
So into a making a request, utilize authentication authorization. By leveraging the across privilege of users, attacker is able to send a request masquerading the user. Once the user account has been compromised, okay, the attacker has exfiltrate, destroy or modify important information. Highly privileged accounts such as administrator and executors are commonly targeted. Data breach, different than specific attack vectors. The data breach is a general term referring to the release of the sensitive information and can occur through malicious actions by mistake. The scope of what is considered a data breach is fairly wide, may consist of a few highly valuable records all the way up to millions of exposed user accounts. So what are the best practice of mitigated vulnerabilities? We can provide the WAF protected against application layer attacks. So the a web application firewall, web application firewall helps protect web applications against malicious HTTP traffic by placing a filtration barrier between the targeted server and the attacker. The WAF is able to protect against attacks like cross-site for Query, cross-site scripting and SQL injections, and lot more we have. Okay, so destination server and the wired web application firewall is basically filter the traffic of HTTP traffic sort of things. And DDoS mitigations, a commonly used method for disrupting a web application is to use the distributed denial of service attacks. Cloudflare mitigates DDoS attacks through a variety of strategies, including dropping volume attacks, traffic or our edge, and using our Anycast network or property routine logmate request without a loss of service. Then how Cloudflare can help you protect web property DDoS attacks. DNS security. The domain name system is a phone book of internet and represents the way in which an internet such as web browser looks up to collect server. Bad actors will attempt to hijack this DNS records process through DNS cache poisoning, man-in-the-middle attack, and the other methods of interfering with the DNS lookup in lifecycle. In DNS, the phone book of the internet and the DNSSEC unspoofable caller ID. Okay, so what we can do it here. So if he's talking about the web application security, okay. So web application security, we can say the web application security is central component of any website. So this is what happened. Web application security deals specifically with the security surrounding web applications and web services. So website, web applications, and web services such as APIs. And what are the common vulnerabilities in the applications? So cross-site scripting, memory corruptions, cross-site request forgery, and data breach. These are the some common vulnerabilities you will find out. So cross-site scripting is basically vulnerability allows the attacker to inject client-side scripts. Okay, so what different scripts are running at the client side. So you know what, at the same time web page, in order to the access important information, same the attacker is going to access the important informations from the client side. Okay, SQL injection is basically okay, different queries are going to run at the same time. And the attacker use the SQL injection to get unauthorized informations, modify or create the new user permissions, and manipulate or destroy sensitive informations. And DDoS attack is a variety of factors such as able to overload aggress servers or the surrounding infrastructure with different traffic. When server is not effectively processing incoming request, it begins to behave strictly eventually into the incoming request. Memory corruption is one of the overflow is basically when software writing data on the defined space in the memory known as buffer. Okay, and buffer overflowing the buffer capacity is that it adjusts memory in the locations being covered in the data. This behavior can be exploited in the measure. So data breach is one of them. Okay, so how can we mitigate the vulnerabilities? So we can mitigate this through the WAF, web application firewall. We can implement. So web application firewall is basically protect the applications against malicious HTTP traffic by placing a filtering barrier between the targeted server and the attacker. The WAF is able to protect against attacks like cross-site scripting, SQL injections, and cross-site forgery. Okay. So you understand the second thing as well. Same time. Okay, so common vulnerability attacks and WAF controls. A third one is basically access cyber risk and proposed application or project. Okay, ability to use the common network tools like nmap, similar tools like Metasploit, John the Ripper, and Mimikatz, and the network security protocols such as TLS and Kerberos. Okay, knowledge of concepts involving public certificates and digital signatures. Ability to read the understand technical maturity of disclosures and then explain them. And ability to think critically and objectively use the data and solve problems. And independently handle multiple tasks, prioritize the meet and deadlines. communication skills, both technical and non-technical issues. Okay, so we have another thing is right now what we can do it, we can go for TLS and Kerberos. We need to find out here. So this is the, well, Kerberos and SSL are both protocols, okay? Kerberos and SSL protocols, both protocols. Kerberos is an authentication protocol, but SSL is an encryption protocol. Okay, SSL secure socket layer is an encryption protocol. Kerberos uses UDP. Okay, SSL uses most of the time TCP. Windows uses Kerberos, for example, when used a domain. Okay, the read node. Kerberos and SSL and TLS. So Kerberos is even called SSL, Kerberos, and both are protocols. Kerberos is authentication protocol, and SSL is encrypted protocol. Kerberos uses LDP. So what is Kerberos? We will just talk about here. So Kerberos is a protocol for authentications between nodes of a computer network over non-secure lines. It allows nodes to provide their identity to one another in the secure manner. It is aimed to primarily at the client's model, server model, and it provides mutual authentications. Okay, both the user and the server verify each other's identity. It is important to understand that Kerberos may be used for authenticate and the client to several different servers at the same time. The cross protocol message is protected against airdropping and reply attacks. Kerberos authentication is widely used in Microsoft products like Windows 2000 and later Windows NT based operating systems. Cross-platform Active Directory integrations vendors have extended the integrated Windows authentication program Unix and Linux platform systems. The protocol is designed to the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT, and was implemented in a software product in the same name, Kerberos. Some confusion stems that the fact is there is several program names. Why does Kerberos use SSL? And SSL is a part of the Kerberos protocol. SSL is not part of Kerberos protocol, but software that use Kerberos for client and the server authentication may use SSL as well. For example, secure black box and use Kerberos for client authentications through JSS API. So what is SSL then? The SSL and TLS is basically, SSL stands for secure socket layer, is a cryptographic protocol that provides secure communications over non-secure network. Okay, so this is basically protocol is provide secure communications over non-secure network. SSL is an obsolete protocol. Its modern version is called TLS, transport layer security. TLS and SSL encrypt the segments of network connections. What they are doing it, they are basically TLS and SSL encrypt segments of the connections using symmetric cryptographic for privacy and keyed message authentications, code for the reliability. TLS provides security and in the sense that it proves its integrity of the data transfers, provide minimum interpretations and certifies that source of this data. As a rule, both not necessarily it encrypts the data. The protocol is implemented in various applications, web browsing, email, instant messaging, voice over IP, etc., and other protocols such as FTPS. So secure black box offers SSL TLS independent transport layer and a part of this protocol like FTPS, SSH, and FFTP. How Kerberos works? So Kerberos is based on symmetric encryption in the trusted third party, but not same in the PKI scheme. Kerberos is a single sign-on system. Kerberos is a single sign system, okay. Drawbacks of Kerberos is basically a single point of failure. Kerberos requires the continued availability of a central server. When the Kerberos server is down, no one can log in. How TLS works? The TLS protocol does not assume the authentication process in the form of the login or sign in on. It is designed to provide secure data exchange between client and server and to prevent overt eavesdropping and the data tampering. The security of TLS is based on public key, symmetric key, and MAC in cryptographic algorithms. The communication starts with the procedures called handshake. During the handshake, client and the servers negotiate various parameters used to establish the connection security. The handshake begins with the client connects to a TLS enabled server, requesting a secure connection and presents a list of supported ciphers and hash functions. From the list, server picks up the strongest cipher and hash functions that is also support for the non-financial client and decisions. The server sends back identifications in the digital certificate. The certificate in particular contains the names, server name, and the trusted certificate authority information and the server's public key. Before proceeding, the client tools providing the PKI ensure that the provided certificate is valid. In order to generate the session keys used to secure connections, the client encrypts a random number of the server's public key and sends the result in the servers. Only the server should be able to decrypt it with its private key. On the basis of this random number, the other information on the parties exchanged during the handshake and they generate a shared symmetric key on the data encryption and the decryptions. Okay, so what we can understand here, so Kerberos is basically is a authentication sort of protocol. Okay, it's used in Microsoft devices like Windows NT or Windows servers. Okay, and cross-site and Kerberos is protocol for authentication between nodes of the computers. It is allows nodes to provide their identity one of the another secure manner. It is aimed primarily at the client-server model, and it provides mutual authentications. Okay, both this user and the server verify each other's identity. It is important to understand that the Kerberos may be used to authenticate to a client and server different servers at the same time. The Kerberos protocol message is against eavesdropping reply and reply attacks. So the Kerberos authentication is widely used in Microsoft products. Okay, and TLS. SSL stands for network layer, and transport layer security, and it's a cryptographic protocol that provides secure communications over the non-secure networks. SSL provides secure communications over non-secure network. SSL is an obsolete protocol. It's modern version of this TLS, transport layer security. TLS and SSL encrypt the segment of network connections using symmetric cryptographic privacy and keys message authentication code of the message availability. TLS provides security in sense of it provides integrity of the data transfer, provides non-reputations, certifies of the source of this data, such as a rule that does not necessarily encrypt the data. This protocol is implemented in various applications, okay? So web browsing, email, instant messaging, voice over IP, such as, okay, so we are using the handshake. How TLS basically works on the login or sign in. Okay, I'm with the Linux Windows based systems in so we have to understand the digital certificates is all about. So, how do I get digital certificate? So, what is the SSL certificate and how does working? A digital certificate is an electronic password that allows a person, organizations to exchange data securely over the internet using the public infrastructure. Digital certificate is also known as public key certificates or identity certificates. So how do you get the certificates? Log in to the select type of entity, fill the necessary steps for entity and POC. Okay. And attachment to an electronic message used for security purposes. The most common use of digital certificate is to verify that the user sending a message is who he or she claims to be, and to provide the when receiver with the means of encoded and reply. What is the difference between digital certificate and digital signatures? So technically speaking, the difference between the digital signature and the digital certificate is that the certificate binds with the digital signatures to an entity, whereas digital signature is to ensure that the data information remains secure from the point it was issued to. So how digital certificates works? The digital certificate contains encrypted form, the public key of the certificate or certificate owner. E-commerce websites use digital certificates to ensure its buyers that they are who they claim to be. Encrypted public key of the certificate owner's identity informations. And what type of digital certificates? We have used the secure socket layer certificate, software signing, code signing certificate, and client certificate as well. What signing certificate is there? A code signing certificate is digital certificates that contains information that fully identifies an entity and is issued by certificate authority, such as Global Sign. Digital certificates binds with the entity of organizations to public that key that is mathematically related to the private pair. Digital certificate is also known as the public key certificates. It is used to cryptographic link ownership of the public key with the entity that owns it. Digital certificates are sharing public keys to be used for encryption and authentications. Okay. And digital certificates include the public key being certified, identified, information about the entity that owns the public key, metadata relating to the digital certificate is digital signature of the public key related to the issue of the certificate These distributions, authentications, and the vocations of digital certificates is the primary purposes of the public infrastructure and system by which public keys are distributed and authentications. So public key cryptography depends on the two pairs. One pair is private key held on the owner and is used by sending the decrypting, and the other one is public key that is encrypt the data sent to the public key owner or certificate holders. The digital signatures enables the entity to share their public key and the widely authenticated. Who issued the digital certificate? The CA authority, certificate authority, is going to issue the certificate. Okay, so digital certificates are generated by the hashing. The data can to be signed and one way cryptographic hash. It result in the encrypted signature's private key. The digital signature incorporates this encrypted hash. Types of digital certificates. So we have SSL certificates, we have transport PLS certificates, organization validated, external validated, code signing. So these are the types of digital certificates. So Devender, I'm just going to wrap up the class right now. So I will provide you the topic which you need to be learn. Okay. Rahul and Devender.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I will provide you on this on the Skype what type of project you need to doing it, and tomorrow we will continue.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, perfect.